Hey everybody, this is Buzz Powell from the National Center for Asphalt Technology on behalf of the Virginia Education Center for Asphalt Technology, and I'm here to speak with you today about cold asphalt recycling, specifically paving and compaction techniques. The content of my presentation is broken down into hauling, transfer, laydown, compaction, testing, and then overlaying. So we're going to start with the basics, start out with hauling. And this is a picture from 2012 at the NCAP pavement test track. When we first built cold recycle sections here, we did that for the Virginia Department of Transportation in a research effort to determine how much hot mix asphalt thickness we need on top of cold recycle bases. And what I like about this slide is you see here that we have a wrap processing unit on site that's processing material that was hauled down to NCAT from Virginia. And then we have a cold recycling plant here. As we process wrap, we're moving it over and we're putting it into the plant. And in this picture, the plant is discharging into a pile. So the two ways to run cold recycle mix from central plant units is to discharge directly into trucks or to dump in a pile, and in this case we're dumping in a pile. And you can't really see there the type of plant that we're using because of the angle, but it is a work in KMA 220 portable coal central plant recycling unit. Now the nice thing about dumping material in a pile, when you have a design for cold recycle mix, essentially it determines the design establishes a binder content, either a foamed asphalt binder content or an emulsion. And it also establishes a moisture content, the moisture that the binder provides strength and stability, and then the moisture provides the lubrication that you need for compaction. So when you start producing this mix, you typically are locked in on the binder content, but what you can vary in order to support construction in the best possible way is the moisture content. And you examine the mix and determine the cohesiveness of the mix, and you and your project engineer may allow you to make some adjustments to the moisture content of the mix as you produce it. Our preferred way, simply so that we don't have to pick the mix up off the ground and then load it into dump trucks, is to discharge directly from the plant into the back of the truck, as you can see in this picture here. This is actually a shot from 70th Street up at the Minnesota Road Research Project in the summer of 2019. When we produced cold recycle mix as part of our pavement preservation research program that we do jointly with the Minro team. It's a joint partnership between NCAT and Minro that's funded through a national transportation pool fund. So that's an action shot from that project. When you haul in dump trucks and you transfer this material, it's important to note that you do not pass it through a material transfer device or a shuttle buggy type piece of equipment. And the reason why you don't do that is because this cold recycle mix, if you've not worked with it in the past, it does not behave as much like hot mix as you might think that it would. And you actually can have some segregation of material in the material transfer device, and you kind of get a big slug of mix that's slinging around in the auger. So it's much better just to discharge directly from the dump truck, from the haul truck, into the paver hopper. Laydown, the paver is going to behave much like it does with hot mix, except for you're not going to have the screed heating system on. This is a completely cold process. There's no heat that is used at the plant aside from the heat that might be needed in a foamed asphalt operation, a hot asphalt storage tank. So you dump material into the paver hopper, and then you make screed adjustments in order to hit the necessary thickness target. You do loot work back behind the paver, and otherwise, there's not as much cohesiveness typically to the mix as you have with hot mix asphalt. But the paving operation is very similar. If you're doing in-place recycling, one of the things that you need to be cautious about when you're planning trucks and you're setting up the paving train is that you actually can build up a little bit of excess material as you work your way down the roadway, and you have to have the trucking resources and the traffic control logistics in place to be able to boom over and remove that material. As you can see in this picture, this is on 70th Street in Minnesota, and I'm standing on the paver, and as you can see in the paver hopper, it's full. We have a full head of material in the hopper, so it's necessary to discharge a little bit of material as we run the hopper down in the paver. And this is because of the fluff that you get when you do the in-place recycling process. This is not the case with central plant recycling. You haul the material out and you install it in the mill hole. So it's a different type of an operation. This is what foamed asphalt can look like behind the paver. Again, this is from 70th Street up in Minnesota. And it's not as shiny black as you might be accustomed to with hot mix asphalt. It has a little bit of a duller appearance, but it is processed wrap. It is a highly engineered product, a very stable product. So it just has a slightly different visual appearance than hot mix. This compares to emulsion in this picture. As you can tell, with the emulsion, it's more of a uniformly coated type of a binder process, so it looks a lot blacker than what you see with the foamed asphalt. But they both can be really high quality products, regardless of whether foamed asphalt is used or if engineered emulsion is used. And this is the reason why the mat looks so much different behind the paver. Foamed cold recycle mix is very much a tack welded wrap looking product. When you use emulsion, engineered emulsion as your binder, it's more evenly coated, and it can look a little bit more like a hot mix because it's much more consistent, as opposed to the tack welded appearance of the foamed asphalt. Moving on to compaction. If you're doing a night paving job, you cannot use emulsion. This is because of the effect that temperature and humidity can have on the breaking of the emulsion and the removal of water. So if you are doing a night job, and by Virginia specifications, it can only be with a foamed asphalt process. If you're working in another state, there might be a different type of a specification. It has to be at least 50 degrees in order for you to work, and you have to be at least 48 hours away from an anticipated freeze event. And that's because it takes a little bit of time to get the moisture out of the mat, even for the foamed asphalt, because you're adding water to the wrap that you're coating with foamed asphalt in order to support the compaction process. With VDOT specifications, you are required to do a 1,000 foot pre-project trial section in order to check your job mix formula. Your project engineer may let you do your pre-project trial section on your job, or it may be located nearby somewhere off your job. You're going to use a control strip, which is a different contract mechanism, to establish your rolling pattern. So the pre-project trial section is going to be done between 1 week and 1 month before you start up to run the project for production, and then the control strip is going to be the first thing that you do when you start actually building your project, so that you can establish your rolling pattern. You're going to need to have at least a 12 ton steel double vibratory roller. The width on the drum has to be at least 78 inches. When you run this machine, you're going to need to run it on high frequency and low amplitude, and you cannot damage the mat. This material is going to behave differently than hot mix asphalt, and if you compact it really aggressively, you can end up doing a lot of damage, doing a lot of scarring to the mat that you'll then have to repair before it'll be suitable for continued construction. Your pneumatic rubber tire roller is going to need to be at least 25 tons. And you need to check your tire pressure on this machine. That's often overlooked with rubber tire rollers. The only way to get good, uniform, nice, and effective compaction is to have the right manufacturer recommended tire pressure in all the tires. You need to start rolling within 30 minutes of paving when you lay this material down. And then you're going to control your effort, monitor your progress with compaction, and prevent dilation of the mat through overcompaction using uncorrected density. So you're going to be out there typically with a nuclear gauge running uncorrected densities to make sure that your rolling pattern is still providing you with the desired outcome. Here's a shot of our pre-project test strip that we did when we built Virginia's test sections here at the NCAP pavement test track back in the summer of 2012. This was a shorter strip. It's not something that we did to comply with VDOT specifications at the time, but we did want to see how does this mix lay down, what kind of density are we going to get as a function of our compactive effort, what kind of scarring are we going to get in the mat that we have to overcome. And then we were also able to use this mat that we put down to do some destructive sampling to support some additional testing that we did. Your actual compaction process, again, this material is not going to be quite as, it's not going to have the same consistency as hot mix asphalt. So you need to be really conscious of the roller marks that you're leaving in the mat, because you are going to have to smooth those out. This is a nice shot of the work that we did on the track in 2012. You got the breakdown roller coming right up behind the paver, and we're there with a nuclear gauge so that we can monitor the compaction process. And you can also tell that this mix has a different visual appearance compared to conventional hot mix asphalt. Moving on to testing, you're going to do testing on your wrap stockpile or stockpiles. You're going to need to record to document what you're doing at your central plant or in your in-place recycler if that's the work that you're doing. And then you're also going to have to document your mat mix properties, and I'll explain what I mean by that here in just a minute. This is the actual processed wrap that we hauled down from Virginia back in 2012. It was a -3/4 processed material. Very, very nice, high quality material. And the mindset change that you need to have as a contractor, if you're going to get into doing cold recycling work, and you're just kind of been accustomed to doing relatively low wrap content hot mix work, is you can't treat the wrap just as it's kind of a secondary material. You have to handle it like it is an engineered material and maintain really good construction practices in order for it to be as consistent and as predictable as possible. Plant documentation is easy. This is the control panel from the work in KMA 220 that we've now used in 2012 and 2015 and then 2019 to build the test sections up in Minnesota. And with this plant, there's your cement feed, and there's your water that you're adding to this mix for compactability, and then there's your binder content. Now in this screen, that shows a set on binder content at 2.5%. That's more than likely a foamed asphalt percent binder. Emulsion typically is going to be 3+, and then a foamed asphalt is typically going to be between 2 and 2.5%. But it's very easy to document this information off this plant, and in fact, it has a data system where you can dump that information directly into an Excel file. But you'll need to document that work and to meet the needs of your project engineer and your inspection team. You need to pull loose mix samples. We have pulled loose mix samples from the back of the haul truck, from the paver hopper, from the screed. You need to work with your project personnel and make sure you pull loose mix samples, representative loose mix samples from the best possible location so that you can be fully compliant with your job requirements. Here's some sample data. This is information from the mix that we ran for Virginia in the summer of 2012. The wrap was hauled down from I-81. It was unscalped but processed to -3/4, as I mentioned earlier. It had a 5.77% binder content at 3% moisture. We foamed 2% virgin binder in, and we foamed it with 2.5% water. We measured 7.7% total binder content of the mix that came out of the coal central plant. So we were able to verify the virgin binder content was 2%, which is what the plant was set up for, was 2%. And then the mixed moisture content was measured at 3.1%. All of our dry densities exceeded 100% on this job. So you need to compare apples to apples. So if you're monitoring compaction, you either compare wet density to wet density or dry density to dry density. Make sure that you're working with your project manager and your inspection team to internally document the work that you're doing. Make sure that your rolling pattern is still working for you, but just make sure that you're communicating the right type of density numbers to the oversight team that you're working with. You need to be careful with this because this is some sample data from when we built these sections back in 2012. And typically you're going to be required in the design to run coated gradations. I like to run coated gradations and also burn gradations. I think my video image might be blocking the percent pass in the number 4 on the burn gradation, but there was a significant, you'll see big differences between the coated gradation and the burn gradation. The reason why I like to do both is because the small changes in the wrap, in the process wrap, can lead to big changes in what you think your coated gradation is, and the burn gradation is more of a basic measure of consistency of the uncoated materials. Like, stuff can stick together and throw off your coated gradation from test to test, and you think you've got a big problem when you don't necessarily have a big problem. And there you can see that on the number 4 sieve, you went from 49% passing the number 4 to 64% passing the number 4. And then the CIR section, there was a big change, and the numbers got really close together. So I like to run coated and also burned and uncoated. You need to submit data that is compliant with your project team. You have to be very conscious of what's happening with water in this mix in order to compare apples to apples to compute the correct percent density. I like doing both wet density on the front end and then also dry density on the back end. I have the luxury of doing that because I'm typically building research test sections. I can go back and cut cores and measure the water content or lack thereof on the roadway sometime after construction. The main thing you need to know is you're comparing density in the field, the wet density or the dry density in the field to the wet density or the dry density through control specimens in the laboratory, an optimum dry density in the laboratory. So you're not comparing it to the same type of theoretical maximum density that you would be doing on a hot mix job. You're comparing it to the laboratory standard compaction control. So it's a different type of thing, and you need to be really conscious of what's happening with the water. And this is some data that we generated in 2015 when we did cold central plant recycling and then cold in-place recycling using both foam and emulsion on US 280 is here in Auburn, Alabama, as part of our pavement preservation experiment. And you see there, you go from the wrap to the loose material at the screed or in the paver hopper to super paved gyratory compactor, and then finally to dried, fully cured specimens. You just need to make sure that the density that you're measuring in the field, you're comparing it to the right thing in the laboratory. And I think that Virginia DOT is going to require you to use the optimum or maximum dry density number. So you're going to need to compare field dry density to lab dry density to it. So you got to account for the water because it is constantly changing, and you need to work with your project inspection team in the central laboratory in order to do that. Now, we found in our US 280 work in 2015 that everything we did was at about 96% average compaction. We were actually at or above 100% when we did the VDOT work back in 2012. So these numbers, this was really good, really stable compaction. We've seen excellent performance with a 1-inch thin overlay on what you see on the screen right here on US 280, but we did not achieve the same level of compaction that we did for Virginia back in 2012. Want to make you aware that there are some really neat testing options that are going to be coming out in the future, ways that you can monitor the quality of the mat. So when we did all of our cold recycle sections in Minnesota in the summer of 2019, a team of researchers came up, and they were researchers from Virginia that were actually involved in this work, and tried all kinds of new tests to assess the quality of the compacted mat. And of course, we did our conventional density testing up here up in Minnesota as well. So a lot of good things are going to come out of that research in terms of what is the stability of the mat, what is the resistance to raveling, that type of thing. And a lot of that data was collected in Minnesota in the summer of 2019 on the 70th Street test sections. Moving on to overlaying, you got this material down, you got a good level of density, good focus on quality. So what about overlaying? Well, your final density test, your density test of record that you're submitting to the department If your mat is not thicker than 3 inches, then you need to use backscatter. If it is greater than 3 inches, you need to use direct transmission. So you got to drive a drill rod and insert a rod in the mat in order to make that measurement. The way I read the specifications, you need to be, for testing during production, you need to be 98% of the control, and the control itself has to be 98% of the maximum dry density in the laboratory. So you need to be, if I'm reading your specifications correctly, work with your project team in order to know that you're interpreting that the right way. As a minimum, for each day of work, you have to be at least 96% of the maximum dry density that the control strip is based on when you set up your rolling pattern. That's an interesting number because that's what we measured out on US 280 was 96%. When you get density on your cold recycle mix, you need to fog seal it with a 0.06 gallon per yard bar rate with emulsion. So that about half of that is the residual rate. And then you need to grit it with 2 to 3 pounds per square yard with grit, with sand, in order to protect the surface from damage from traffic. You can't put rolling traffic on the mat until you get 2 hours past the completion of compaction on that mat. So no less than 2 hours for rolling traffic. You have to repair any raveled area, any spot that's been damaged by traffic, raveling, loss of material, prior to overlay. And then you have to make sure that moisture is no greater than 50% of the optimum moisture for compaction before you can overlay it. So this means you got to have time to get water out of the mat. And if you're trying to decide whether to do foamed asphalt or emulsified asphalt, it's a little simpler process with foamed asphalt because you don't have to concern yourself with the water that comes from the emulsion that facilitates that coating that we talked about earlier. Take good care, take great care with construction equipment. If you're having to drive on the mat, if you've got a material transfer device or haul trucks, paver, whatever, make sure that you're not damaging the mat as you get set up to prepare for the overlay. Here's a picture of our fog seal shot up in Minnesota in the summer 2019 on 70th Street. It's a great picture because our contractor that we use to do our distributor shots did an outstanding job. It was a brand new truck and it had perfectly sized, properly sized nozzles, very well maintained, calibrated shots, and it was like we had spray painted everything that we shot. So that's a good picture of a well done fog seal. When you go in and you start to pave and you're doing the overlay, you may see a little bit of light pickup in the cold recycle mix, and this is a shuttle buggy that we were using to pave here. We were actually putting down a 1 inch thin overlay as our riding surface directly on top of our cold recycle mix on 70th Street. See a little bit of pickup. That's not a lot of damage to the mat, but you need to watch that and be conscious of that, because if you do start to damage the mat, then you need to go back and look at options, maybe potentially some more grit or something, some change in your construction practices, so you're not tearing it up before you're overlaying it. You definitely don't want to do that. Here's another shot from 70th Street. As you can see, we are using a shuttle buggy to supply mix to the paver. This may look a little thick out here at this turnout, but actually this mat is only 1 inch thick. Directly on top of cold recycle mix. We did in-place recycling, central plant recycling, using both foam and emulsion, and we also did a full depth reclamation using both foam and emulsion, and then we came in and just did a 1 inch overlay on all of that, as well as just doing a 1 inch overlay on the existing surface. This job turned out really nice, and if you look ahead down that road, down towards that water tower, there is a ready-mix concrete plant down there, so you've got loaded material trucks going in the direction of paving, and then ready-mix concrete trucks that are loaded and mixing that are driving out towards us as you look at this picture. So this road actually sees a lot of traffic, a lot of heavy truck traffic, and it's an outstanding opportunity to compare just a thin overlay, two different types of recycling options, as well as hot mix asphalt, deeper hot mix asphalt mill and inlay, 2 inches versus 3 inches versus all of the recycling options. There's a shot of the finished roadway striped with the shoulders pulled up, and very smooth project. Extremely pleased with the outcome of this. And in the cold recycle test sections, there is no cracking, there is no appreciable rutting. So just with the 1 inch overlay, performance is outstanding. We do have a little bit of cracking with the FDR sections, which is kind of surprising to us. It's not excessive, it's not bad. There is a little bit of cracking that we've mapped, and we do have reflective cracking just in the 1 inch overlay. But the story is very good for cold recycle mix, and we're very pleased with the performance of those test sections there on 70th Street, because there was a extensive amount of cracking in those sections. That road was torn all to pieces before we installed those sections. So if you do a good job with mixed production and placement and compaction, and then take care when you're installing the overlay, you can expect your cold recycle project to turn out really well. So I wish you all the best of luck with that in the future. Thank you so much for your time.